Okay, now it's time for the big topic. Sorry, please. Sorry. This is the big topic for today's lesson. That is the style of the web page. It's a big topic, but we are going to use it not so much. Okay. I would say that the most important part of this topic is not the presentation part, how to render text in a given position, red, blue, highlighted, bigger or smaller, but is the selectors. The selector part, okay? That means how we identify the text, that is the element in the page, that of which we would like to change the presentation. Okay, because selectors are used also for programming in the web page, okay, not just for presentation. Okay, so stay put for when I will explain the selectors. Okay, the main goal of the CSS, that stands for Cascading Style Sheets, is to define in a sheet, in a piece of file, the style of the elements in the web page. The last standardization is CSS3, that is like HTML5 for the HTML part. And also you will find some references online and in the Mozilla Developer Network. It's a big family of standards. Let's start from the syntax. CSS is based on rules. Okay? Rules, this is a rule, and the rule is made by a selector that identifies the HTML element or elements to which this rule will be applied. Okay, H1, for example, it says that this rule has to be applied to all the elements tagged as H1. Okay, and after the selector, you put the curly braces, and the rules. The rules are made by a property, column value, and semicolon. This is a declaration, and this is another one. Okay, so each declaration is name, column, value, and they are separated by the semicolon. Every name refers to a CSS property, color, background color, font size, and so on. Okay, there is a huge number of properties, and those properties can be assigned a value that can be the color, can be the size, in this case, can be a given label that has some meaning. Okay. So this is again the syntax where there is the declaration block separated by the selector. You can write multiple declarations in the declaration block separated by the semicolon, and you can also put multiple selector in the selector part separated by a comma. Okay, this is in the case I want to apply this rule not only to the header but also to other elements. I don't need to replicate the rule, I just have to add another selector. Okay. And okay, it refers to the structure of the HTML, and the styles are called cascading, because they cascade on the children. Okay? So if you define a rule for the body, okay, this rule, color green, cascades, extends to all the children, okay, the descendants of the body. Okay? You can override, this is a sort of override, to change the behavior of a children, a descendant, by defining a rule specific for this descendant. So, if you define a rule that is specific for a tag, it will override the rule that has been defined on the ancestors. Okay? They, in this way, you can propagate the rule, but change in some particular point. Okay, so a more specific rule overrides a general one. There is a lot of, let's say, rules for defining this override and the cascading. I will not go through all of them. You will see them referred in the slides, but is if you go into the details, it's a real mess. So I will just use some simple cascading and simple override. Okay. There is plenty of properties, and I will show you only some of them. Again, go to see the reference on the Mozilla Developer Network or Google it to find how to make a list appear horizontally instead of vertically, and they will tell you, okay? I will give you only the general information. Okay, let's see some examples. For example, this rule that is between the curly brackets, for example, I would like to apply that to a paragraph, so I will put the P in front of that, and it says that, that there are some rules, property, that means some values assigned to some properties. Okay, so when I'm working with widths, font size, margin, and so on, I need to specify some metrics, some units, okay? How big I want a font, how large I want a margin, okay? So I specify a number and a unit, and there are different units. They can be, for example, pixels. So I will write a number followed by px without the space. That means 10 pixels. I want that the margin is 10 pixels. This is a fixed unit that depends on the screen. Let's say it does not depend on the screen because it will be 10 pixels if the screen is small and 10 pixels if the screen is very big. So, it's too much absolute. We prefer to use other units that are more relative, and in particular, M and rem that are related, they are relative to the font size. Okay? When you open a web page in a browser, if the display is small, also the font size is small. If the display is very large, the browser selects a larger font size as a default, okay? So if you refer all your measures, all your spaces, margin, and so on to the font size, they will be adapted somewhat to the display, okay? So this is a better way to define the size of anything, okay? There is also the percentage that is not bad. For example, for the width of an element, you can define 100%, 50%, 25%, and so on. It's also relative. And this is relative to the viewport. That sometimes is used. We don't use that too much. So prefer relative units, and RAM is the preferred one nowadays. And we will use them as soon as we see the CSS selectors. Okay, you can, the role of the selectors, as I said, is to identify the elements on the page you want to apply the style on, okay? And there are different kind of selectors. There are selectors that refer to elements, that is tags, okay? You use the tag name as selector. For example, H1, this is a selector for the tag H1. And you say color red, okay? Or A, background color blue, okay? This is the selector, and it is exactly the name of the tag. Then there is the class selector, okay? So let's go to see some example. In the class selector, is a little bit different from the element selector, because with the elements, you already have the tags in the page, and so you refer to the tag that already exists. With the class selector, it's your duty to place the class attribute somewhere, and then use this label in the CSS rule to refer to all the elements where you put this class label, okay? As we saw in the previous exercise, okay, we have used the highlight class, and we can write a style rule. The simplest thing to write the style is to add a style block in the header, and write the rule here. For example, H1 font size 2 rem. Does it change something? Okay. As you see, if I use 1 rem, H1 becomes small. If I use 4 RAM, becomes very large, and so on. And this is the H1 tag. If I would like to refer to a class, I need to use the dot in front of the class name. So I will write dot, that means this is a class, highlight, background, color yellow. As you see, I write the rule. The rule is applied to the div and to all the descendants. Okay? If I move this class to this paragraph, it's overridden by this inline style, because the more specific is the style, the more it has a higher priority. But if I remove that, I just leave. Let's see one thing. In this case, you have a style editor here in the page. No, inspector. Here it is. Layout, style, computed style. I move to this one. Okay. You see that in case if I select this element, okay, in the console, I see that there is a style for the highlight class that is background color yellow, but is cancelled because there is a more specific style on the element itself that override the other one. Okay? If I remove this, this becomes active because this does not exist anymore, and the element will be yellow background. Okay, so always refer to this part of the developer interface to analyze the CSS. Okay, you select an element and you look in this part of the developer console. Okay, if I remove these, okay, it becomes yellow, and I can, for example, replicate these here, so they are both yellow. Okay, it's recording. Yes. Okay, so remember, with the class you have to put the label of the class, okay, and then refer to that in the rule. You can also assign multiple classes, like for example highlight and question. They are separated by space, and you can say that question font size to 2 rem okay, so question text is both highlighted and styled for a question. Okay. Usually the class names have a semantic meaning. Okay, for example, question, that means this tag, this class, I'm going to tag these elements with this class because those are questions. I can use warning, where I put some text that is a warning, and so the style of the warning will be text color red because it's a warning. Okay, so you use you define a class name that has usually some semantic meaning, okay, and assign a rule. I would like also to say something about the selectors. If you look at the web page, selectors are classes and are used everywhere. For example, if I look to this place, this part of the Polito website, I see that there are a lot of classes that are used. For example, this text is a tag, anchor tag, inside an element with class poll teaser title. Okay. How can I select this tag? I can use the syntax for the selectors, go into the console and say $, and then between quotes the selector. Since it is a class, I have to start, with a dot, poll the name of the class. Okay, and then you see I have selected all the elements in the page with this class. Okay, and for example, I can use I can use map, and from each one of these elements retrieve inner text, and this is the text of all those elements. Okay, and this is selector can be used also for web scraping. Okay, and I don't know how to go to the next line. why I don't see that. Let's clear that. Okay. And for example, I can join that with a new line and use the copy function to copy all the text and let's say write all the text somewhere, okay? So selectors are also important for programming and web scraping. There is the ID selector. The ID selector is not referred to a class, but is referred to an ID, and the syntax is with the hashtag before, okay? Remember, the ID selector must be unique in the page. There is also some selector for the attributes, href, and so on, src, etc., but I have no time to go through them. There are pseudo class selector. For example, a link that has been visited, a link where the mouse is over the link, and so I can change the color of the link if I move the mouse over the link, and so on. And there is also a syntax to combine the selectors. For example, in this case, there is a link, an anchor inside an element with class pointis or title. So I can write like this one. I can write dot poll teaser title space A, and it means get the element with this class, but not the element itself, the children that is an anchor. Okay, so the anchor that is children of this element that has this class. Okay, and this is the syntax. Okay, if I know that A is a direct children, okay, and not just a descendant, I can just retrieve the direct children with this syntax instead of this one. This one retrieves all the link that are descendants, this one only the link that are direct children, and so on. And there are a lot of other rules. Okay, I already showed you how to change the display. There is also a display property and a visibility property. The difference between display none and visibility hidden is that when you define display none, the element disappears and the space is filled by the subsequent element in the page. When you just turn off the visibility, the element does not disappear, just is not showed, but it takes the space in the page. So the other component of the page do not shift in its place. Okay? And for example, it can be useful to just hidden the visibility and not have all the other elements move inside the page. Okay, there are a lot of pseudo classes and so on, but I will skip them. Then there is the cascading that I already talked about with the different priority. We have seen how to put the style inside the header, but it preferred to put the style in a separate file. How can we do that? We do that like that. we create a new file that is a CSS file style. We copy the content in this file and we refer the file from the web page. Okay, so let's go to that. We get the style. We create a new file that is style.css in the same folder. We write the rules without the tag. We save the file. So I remove the style from here. You see the style disappeared because it's no more present in the page. I can add a link, that's relative style sheet, rel equal style sheet. Okay, and then type text CSS. If I remember right, href equal style.css, and if everything is correct, the style is retrieved from the file and applied to the page. Okay, this is the preferred way. So you isolate the style in another document. On the other side, the inline style is, we don't like it very much. It's not recommended because you put style HTML all together and it becomes a mess. Those are the priority rules, but they are really complex. I will not go through them. I will say a little bit about the box model. That means that every element that you put in a page occupies some space. Okay, this is called the box. And the space is made by the content itself, for example, the text. Okay, but in addition, there is the border, the padding, and the margin. They have all a different meaning. Okay, let's say the margin is the space outside the border, and the padding is the space inside the border. Okay, so if you want to put a border and distanciate the border from the content, you use the padding. If you want to keep apart the border with the other element of the page, you increase the margin. Okay, that's the difference. And this is, this is the total space occupied by your element in the page. Okay, if you go in this view, you see that the browser shows you the size of the content, the size of the padding, the size of the border, and the size of the margin. You can increase the border size, and in this case, there is the top border, the bottom border, the left border, and the right border. The top margin, the bottom margin, the left margin, and the right margin. Okay. If you use just one number, it means all the borders with the same width or color. And if you use different numbers, it means you can specify the size of each side of the border. Okay. It's just useful to know that. Then we move to another topic that is important, and is the layout. So how elements are placed in the page. Okay. Before we say that the HTML browser takes every element and puts every element beside the previous one. Okay? If the element is a block, besides means on the next line. If the element is in line, it means beside, on the same row. Okay? This is the flow of the rendering of the web page. And you can change that with the layout methods. Historically, was defined first the float layout, then the grid layout, and then the flex layout. They are specifications of the box model and the inline and block properties we have already seen. Okay, but since those are old, we are going to use just the flex one. I'm referring to the other ones just because if you open a page, you know what is float and what is grid. Okay? So, a little bit on positioning. There is a property that is called position. Okay? You can specify that property for a given set of elements. And this property has a meaning that says how to interpret the left and the top properties. In this case, left and top means that the position, let's say here, the position of this corner will be left 20 pixels and top 20 pixels with respect to something. What is this something? If the position is static, the label of the property position is static, it means ignore them. Just put in the default place. If the position is defined as relative, it means that left and top refer to the block position in the normal flow. So the browser was going to put the element there in the normal flow, just shift by left and top. If position is absolute, it refers to the containing block, okay, not the normal flow. And if it is fixed, it refers to the viewport, and in this case it's similar to the static one, but it will not scroll with the containing block. Okay, just do some test and look at these references to do some experiment with that. Okay, there is also the Z index, that means if it is more in foreground or more in background, depending on the value of zeta index, and so you can hide one element with another one, depending on the zeta index. I will skip the floating and the grid layout. Okay. And I'm moving to the flexbox layout. The flexbox is interesting because it's the last one, and it's not so difficult to learn. But you have to focus on this definition in particular. You need to know what is the container and what are the items. Okay? For example, in this case, I can say that I define a div that contains some other div. A, B, and see. Okay, so in this case, what happens is that the container is this one, and those are the items. What are the items? They are the direct children of a flex of a container. Okay, so direct children means that is the direct child of this one. If there is something like that, okay, div is the children, direct children, but span is not more the direct children. Okay, that's the difference. So the flexbox layout is made of a container and the items. Okay, and defines how the items are placed inside the container. Okay, to enable the flex layout, you have to define the style. I will write it in line. Style display flex. Okay, this is a column. Okay, this way you enable the flex layout, or in a separate sheet you do something like that. And what can we do with the flex layout? We can define the alignment of the three children, for example, as I said, A, B, and C, A, B, and C, that can be left, can be right, can be go horizontal or go vertical. It can be change the order or increase, this is larger than the other one. Okay, there are a lot of combinations. For example, you can have something like that, that is again A, B, and C, where I explicitly defined a class container for this one and item for the other to remember their role. Okay, and if you enable the flexbox display and use the property justify, you can decide if A, B, and C are in the center, and if you write center. If you write flex start, they move to the beginning. If you write flex end, they move to the end. Okay? If you write space around here, instead of the other one, they will be spaced. Okay? And if you write space between, they will be spaced, but here there is no space in the border. So they are different behavior for defining the layout of the items inside a container. Okay? There is some wrapping, that is some vertical alignment, direction, and so on. Okay? There is also some sort of grouping, if you want. Those are all the properties. In the lab, for example, let's see a real example. Okay. let's look okay. For example, when you will have to design a navigation bar, okay, you can design those elements as items of a Flex container. Depending on the justify content property, you can define where they are positioned in the navbar. Okay? So for example, B on the left, this one in the center, and this one on the right part. How can you do that? You group all those together and those together. So this one, this group, and this group are direct child of the container, and you use justify something that we have seen before. For example, space between. Okay, and they are put like that. If you use justify center, they will be put in the middle. Okay, I'm going very fast on that because the important part of this lesson is what follows. I don't have too much time to talk about the responsive layout, but the important part is this framework. In this class, we prefer not to use directly the CSS, but to rely on a framework that is called Bootstrap that defines the styles itself. Okay. And defines the styles so that they can work in every browser without errors and so on. And we can use a simpler syntax to define the positioning and the appearing of the elements in the page. Okay? And it's called Bootstrap. You will find that on the looking for Bootstrap on the web. The website is Get Bootstrap, this one. The latest version is 5.3, okay? And it comes with a default layout that is pretty, and we can work with that. If you go in the Bootstrap introduction, intro, where is that? Introduction. Okay. They tell you how to use Bootstrap. To use Bootstrap, you need to include a CSS. This is a style sheet. Where is the name? This one. A style sheet in the header, and for some animation and interaction with the user, also a JavaScript file. Okay. So it's sufficient that you get, this link. For example, you copy this file, copy, edit, paste. Let's create a new one. 02QA Bootstrap HTML. Okay. We copy everything. We put that here. And what happens is that we get the link of the style sheet, and we overwrite our style sheet with the Bootstrap one, and we copy the source and put at the end of the JavaScript, this one, and put at the end of the page. And if we look at our document, is a little bit different. And we are going to play with, no, it's not this one,
is this one.
Okay, you see, it's different. The text changing, the spaces changed, and so on. Okay? And what happens with Bootstrap? It happens that we can customize our element with some classes that are already defined by Bootstrap. Okay, so if we would like to use, for example, the table class defined by Bootstrap, we go in our page, and in the table, instead of border one, we write class equal table. And you see the appearance of the table changes. If we would like to customize it even more, we can go, to the Bootstrap page. We look for table overview, and we see that there are some variants. So for example, there is the striped row table. So we copy the code. The class is table, table stripe. And so we write table stripe. And as you see, there is only one line, we put two. Now there are two lines, and we put three. You see the table is striped, okay? And if we would like to have a navigation bar, we look at Bootstrap, and we look for navigation bar, and they say, you can create a navigation bar. We look for the one we like the most. No, it's not this one. Okay, this navbar. We select one of them. I was looking for a simple one. For example, this one. So you see, this is the content of the navbar, the text, an image, and so on. And so I take all this stuff and I put that in my header, and I just write if overrun. I save, and the image is not working. I cancel that, and you see the navbar has been customized. Okay, so what we are going to use Bootstrap, because there are some predefined styles, we just grab them from the website and use them in our page, instead of working with all the CSS styles and so on. If you, I updated the slide this morning, so you will find this slide in on the website. There are some, let's say, Bootstrap alternatives to the CSS to customize the page. I don't have time to go through the grid system. I can do something. This is maybe the most interesting. I leave you to look at the other part of the slides, especially for the lab, okay, before the lab. The layout of Bootstrap is by default based, just 2 minutes, on a grid system. That means that, as a default, it reasons as the web page has 12 columns. And you can space your elements, 1, 2, 4, 6 columns, with a class like that, okay? 6 columns. So if you know that there are 12 columns in a page, you want 2 elements, one beside the other, half the page, you say that one is called 6 and the other is called 6. So they have the same size. You can also write call 4 and then call 8, and so this one will be larger. Okay? To use that, you need to have a parent container that is of the class container, and the element must be in a row. Okay, so the idea is container with multiple row. Every row is made of multiple columns. We just see an example here, and then we are mostly done. I can say class container. Okay, you see all the main section has become a container. You see that by the spaces. Then I say that this is a row, okay, and this is a call 10, while this one is a call 2. And so what happens is that the question takes 10 columns, and this one takes 2 columns. Okay, this way you can quite easily arrange the element inside the page. Okay, and then I let you go and look at the spacing, the components, the helpers, and the icons before the lab. Is there a question?
We can revise the Bootstrap CSS with our.
Yeah, if you go to the website, they say you how you can override that. You just have to redeclare a style or add a style, additional style to the Bootstrap class. Yeah, yeah.
Using also the same
class with our CSS. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Your CSS will override the Bootstrap one. Okay, so you can override that. And by means of the helpers and the spacing, you can also customize, not just override, but add more margin, different color, and so on. Okay, so the preferred way is use the Bootstrap syntax, okay, if you can, and use the style, the CSS, only if you cannot do otherwise. Any other question? Okay, we can look, have time to see the example, okay? And so let's customize better this page, okay? What can we do? Okay, let's try to customize the navbar, okay? So there are some examples I showed you before. Just a moment, examples, okay. For the headers. Okay, if you, I don't know why there is no the source code, but if you go in the inspector, and you look at one of them, for example, this one, you can retrieve the syntax. Okay. So what do we see here? We see that this navigation bar is an header, let me see, this is not with the dnav. Do you see a nav here? No. So I would prefer the other one. Okay, the black one. Okay. Let's debug this a little bit. There is a HTML tag that is the header. That means this is the header of your web page. That is a semantic information. And they created a container inside the header, and inside that there is an ordered list that has been used as a navigation. Okay, what you can do is, let's say, just copy copy HTML. Let's see. No, like that it's too difficult. I will try with a simpler one, maybe from this section. Okay, this one. Okay, so let's go through navigation header. Okay, what happens is that, as you see, Bootstrap defines some components. Okay, the documentation of Bootstrap is divided in parts, and those are layouts. Okay, layouts, the most important part is the container thing that says that you can use a container, and then inside a container you can define the rows and the columns. Okay, we have already seen that. Okay, the other part is content. Content, for example, says that you have styles for the tables, and we already used the style for the tables. You can look at additional information, okay, here, how to differently customize the table. For example, there is this table over that has some additional behavior, because if you move over the rows of the tables, they are highlighted. So if you take this class and put this class here without the dot, also your table becomes a hover table. Okay? There is some information about the typography. So Bootstrap has some styles for the headers. Okay? And you can customize the headers. For example, there is this class lead that allows you to have a paragraph with an increased font size. So it becomes maybe helpful for the question text. So I go into the code, and there is where there is the question text, I can say lead, and you see it becomes larger. Okay, maybe I can move H2 in the next row, so it's not affected by that. I can change, I don't like that, I can change the column size, and you see they are moved. Okay. Then again, following the documentation of the web page, there are the forms. We are going to skip those because we are using that when we are going to program the web page. Then there are the components. Components are a particular, you will see also components in React. What is the meaning of a component? A component is, let's see, is some HTML element that has been enhanced. by means of a custom style defined by the style sheet and a custom behavior defined by the JavaScript. Okay? For example, our table that behaves like that is quite a component. This behavior is not done by JavaScript, but only with CSS. Okay? There are instead other components that have a more clear behavior. For example, the accordion. How many of you do know the accordion? Nobody? Accordion is a bit our paragraph, let's say boxes, where you can show only one of them at a time. Okay? So this is an HTML element enriched with this presentation, but also the behavior that you can open only one at a time. Okay? How can you create an accordion in your web page? You copy this code, put in your web page and change the text. This is how Bootstrap works. It's simple like that. It's easier to copy the code and customize that than, let's say, copy all the classes and find out which one is needed and which one not. Okay, so you look for an example that is what you want to realize and you copy the code. There are a lot of examples, so you probably find the one that you like. For example, for buttons, okay, we see that there is this syntax where there is a base class that is called button that defines the base behavior. Okay, so we go to our button, this one, we create the button. Okay. And by doing that, this is just an HTML default button. If we add the class button, it becomes a Bootstrap button, but it's the base class. You can additionally customize it with the variants. For example, I would like to have a button that is green, so I will use the button success variant and I add this variant. So I go to the page and I see that my vote is customized like that. Okay? And there are a lot of examples of different customizations. Okay? You just decide the aspect, take the class name and put in your page. Then there are a lot of other things, and helpers and utilities are some class names that give you some more specific customization. Let's look at the slide. Okay, for examples, you can use the flex behavior. Okay, and to use the flex behavior without using directly the CS code, you use a display utility that is called dflex. Okay, so when you put dflex in a class, that means that this becomes the container and those becomes the items. Okay, let's try to see an example. Okay, where can we work out this example? For example, here. We can use dflex and remove the colon, because the flex layout can be an alternative to the colon. We can also remove the style that is inline. Doesn't mean seems too flexible to me. Okay, deflex, and try to use a justify content start. Does not work. Yeah, the main problem with deflex, with the flex behavior, is that if you don't put correctly, okay, maybe I cannot use that in a row. So, div flex. Okay, now it worked. Sometimes there are some conflict, okay? I was trying to use deflex with row and there was a conflict. I can use deflex inside a row, okay? And now it works because if I put justify content start, question and by Antonio Servetti are on the start part. If I write end, they are moved to the end. If I write, do you remember, was center? They are put in the center. Maybe I want to increase the space between those two, okay? And in Bootstrap, I have the spacing syntax. There are some classes, predefined classes, that have this syntax. Property, where M stands for margin and P for padding. So if I want to modify the margin, I write M. Then I can put T, B for top or bottom, S for start, A for end. So if I want a margin start from the left, I write like that. And then there is dash, and the size, where 0 is the smaller and 5 is the larger. So I can write, for example, 2. Okay, look at the documentation about the meaning of the size. So I can also use those classes to create some spacing. For example, this I want maybe in the second margin start 2, sorry. And you see the margin has been increased. It's too low, I can write 5. And you see the margin is n times, not really 5, the default margin, okay? I can also use, for example, in this row, margin top 4. And you see this margin has been increased. So is very, very below the navigation bar. Okay, so there are those properties with which you can customize the details of the spacing, of the padding, and so on. There is also the container fluid that has a different behavior because it uses 100% of the web page. Okay, the other was just using the center of the page with a maximum size, and so on. I think I said most of it. For the lab, for example, if you want to use icons, there is a special CSS that is Bootstrap icons. Okay, those icons are considered and rendered as fonts. Is a trick that they can use to display icons, not images, but just icons that are in format SVG, that is a vector format. So you can look online at Bootstrap icons. Okay. The bad thing about this page is that your information is way below, okay. Here it is. You get the link of the CSS. You put the link in the web page. And then you can use the icons as a classes. For example, oh, sorry. Where is icon font? If I write I, that is a new tag, and the name of the icon with B in front of it, I will render, for example, in the navigation bar, an icon, okay? And I can change the style of the icon with the fonts. For example, I increase the style, I change the color, and so on. Better to write that in a style sheet, okay? And I change the icon. You don't need to import the SVG file or things like that. Just refer to this point, to this example, okay? One important thing about the CSS and the importing, have you seen when you import the JavaScript libraries that you need to verify that this is the right file and not an hacked file? So also with the CSS and with the JavaScript, you can compute the CRC of the library and put this CRC in the HTML page with this syntax. The attribute integrity equal and the syntax for the CSS, the CRC and the value. Okay, in this way, the browser checks that the library, JavaScript library or CSS, the external file you are going to import, is the right one because it matches this CRC integrity code. Okay, if it does not match, the library or the CSS is not loaded. Okay, as you noticed, when I was using this. This link, there was no integrity. You look here. So one thing to do is to change that and add the integrity attribute. Okay? Remember, do you remember that for the lab? Okay? So every external resource that can execute something malicious in your web page needs to be checked by this integrity. Okay, if I remember right, Professor Masala told you how to compute that, so you can compute the integrity value yourself. If you don't find that on a website or in a library. Okay, the last thing about this class is something I skipped before. That is the responsive design. Does someone knows already what is a responsive design? Very few? Okay. If you go to the website of the Politecnico and we ask ourselves, is it responsive? Means does it adapt to the size of the screen? Okay. For example, if you look at the website from a browser, that's a big screen, it appears like that. If you decrease the size of the screen, you see that it changes. There is no more the navigation bar, but there is this hamburger button with the navigation bar hidden inside it. This is a responsive behavior. adapts the layout of the page depending on the screen size. In your browser, there is also this button here that allows you to use different screen size, different orientation, and so on. You can change, there are some presets for iPhone or other smartphone. Okay, so you can test the responsiveness of your website. Okay, I will not go into the detail. I would like only to show you the grid system. We're using Bootstrap because its grid system can be made responsive. Okay, if I find an example, okay, I will show you. Okay, if you change a little bit the syntax of the column with those modifiers, small, larger, and so on, that are two letters acronym, what happens is that your columns can adapt to the layout of the page. Okay, and they can move. Maybe it's easier. It moves all the page. Okay. Let's try this one. Okay. You see, they move around instead of being or forcing themselves to be on the same line. If you decrease the size, the width of the web page, they move below. Okay. Then don't stay on the same line. This is some sort of responsiveness, okay? So we are not working with responsive layouts in the lab, but if you want, your page using Bootstrap can be made responsive, okay? Just look at this part about the grid system, how you can make it responsive, okay? In our example, we are showing you non-responsive syntax, but you can make it responsive if you study a little bit, okay? Any question at the end?
Tomorrow, could you show us how to check
the interview because we don't have seen how the link ends? Okay, the idea is to use OpenSSL, okay? And what happens, I can put that in a... How to check or to compute? How to compute, yeah, it's like that. There are some tools, in this case OpenSSL, that can compute the digest, the integrity value, given an algorithm, okay, offer a text file that you are giving to the tool. So in this case, you write the content of this file to the tool that is OpenSSL. It computes the digest and encode it in base 64. Okay, so if I run that, you see, I get this answer. Oops. I get this answer that is the digest. And I need to put integrity equal, I don't remember exactly. The syntax, okay, like that. The algorithm dash the integrity value, okay, and the check is done, the computation is done. Okay? No, you download the file from the website, you check the file. That's not so easy. You check the file that is not does nothing not safe, and compute the digest. Okay. Usually they give you, you have to download from a trusted website and so on. Okay, that's all. Tomorrow there will be Professor Masala, then another lesson, and the lab about these things will be next week.